Если тебе сколько это не так, то
Ага. Давайте уточним по языку лекции. Мне стоит пробовать на английском. Так, ссылку. Сейчас, один момент. На английском. Русским, украинским, English, please. Okay, I see. Okay. One moment, I will send you a link. So I need to share access to it. Okay, anyone with the link can view. Okay. Да, я разговариваю и на русском, или на английском, но вопрос, что нам нужно, но, судя по всему, we have English speaking guys. Okay. Does the link works for you? Yeah, I see. Okay. Okay. Yep. Okay, it will be not easy to give you all information in English, so sometimes I probably will switch to Russian or Ukrainian, but presentation is completely in English, so main information which I wanted to give to you is okay. I will enable presentation again, like this. Okay, so the topic which I wanted to tell you about is efficient implementation and code optimization. So why I think this topic is important for you, it's kind of very unusual for competitive programming, you know, like we usually have lections on terms of segment tree or flows or some kind of dynamic programming task, but this is kind of some global team which can help in different situations for different kind of tasks for you. It should kind of improve all overage performance, I hope, yeah. So the points which I want you to give about why is it important. So first point, it's dangerous to write solutions that is much slower than it might be. What does it mean? That like, if you will use some algorithm or operations which are known or that they are very slow, you can basically get the time limit even with absolutely correct and good idea of solution. So that's why you usually should start like implementing the solution which is already kind of uses the best things which you can. Obviously, if it not make your implementation much harder. There are some cases, second point, when we can meet some problem where time limits are quite tight just because also we wanted to cut off some solution with larger asymptotic. For example, like one more log in asymptotic and also don't want you to submit this solution. So he put very tight time limits and like you have not enough space or freedom for make mistakes in terms of efficiency of your code. Also, sometimes with very efficient implementation, you can actually submit a solution and get accepted with it, while your asymptotic time complexity of your solution is much worse than the what also expected from you. It's rare cases, and sometimes you can say that it's bad prepared problem, but still it can happen. It can happen, and it's not bad from your side to implement such solution. Next point, it's useful to evaluate not only the asymptotic of time complexity, but constant factor and expected execution time as well. So, you know, like n log n solutions are not all the same. If you use binary search or if you use STD map, you can get like 10 times different performance, different execution time, just because like it's terms of not algorithmical time complexity, but terms of your code efficiency. So it's really important when you try to evaluate like probable execution time of your solution to know what is slow and what is fast and how to make your solution faster. Okay, next point is, yeah, basically it's what I said, that with the same time for complexity and even like with the same algorithm, you can achieve absolutely like different in tens or hundreds times execution time. Okay, so I think it's kind of important for successful participating in competitive programming to know like how to write efficient code and how to avoid bad situation with time limit with good solution. So what about my English? What about the process, how we start the lesson? Is it looks fine? Like to stamp of my speech and so on. Александр Владимирович, все ли хорошо? Продолжаем ли мы так на английском или... Окей. Okay. Understandable, I see. Окей. Okay. But there is such a quote from Donald Knuth, in which he said in his book in 1960, premature optimization is the root of all evil. That basically means that we shouldn't optimize everything which we write. And you know, like 50 or 60 years ago, it was absolutely different situation with machines which programmers had, which with how to say tools and so on. But this situation is like actual even now. So your task, your main goal on competitive program is to solve the task. You should firstly think about correct idea, about what like after expected, and don't try to optimize everything. Don't try to optimize an efficient code before you're completely sure that like your idea can pass and it's correct. And like last point here is that effective is more important than efficient. So being effective is doing the right things means that you find solution, you implement solution, and it's more better than you try to optimize some front solution. It usually very important. Yeah, so please do not forget about that. Next point, like the main principles which we can use for effective implementation, fewer operations, the fewer operations, the faster. It's obvious, like if we can cut off some loop by like loop number of iterations by two, then we do that. If we even can remove some if from our code, we do that. Like it's obvious, there is nothing to teach you about this principle. Efficiency of working with memory, we will talk about it later during this lecture. Avoiding slow operations, slow data structures, and slow approach, so this is also what I will talk about. So for example, like you have binary search, you can have a set, std set in C++, and sometimes you can solve the same task like finding lower bound, for example, in sorted array or in std set, but with binary search it will be much more efficient, much more faster. So same time per complexity, but just different data structure, different operations, and it will basically affect your code if it's used in the bottleneck. So the idea is here to tell you which things are slow and which are fast in implementation of solution. Yep. And also like about second point, efficiency of working with memory, it's absolutely like super important because even if we think that memory access like read and write is all one with but it's actually not so, and it's very important to have efficient work with memory. Next part of my lecture will be about C++ STL features, like some things which we use in mostly every program, and so this lecture is mostly about C++ as well, because in competitive programming you really can't achieve huge level of optimizations with something like Java or Python. So right now C++ is the only tool, only instrument which we have for getting like really efficient solutions. Some contests allow us to submit every like some solution in Java, and they can guarantee that there is solution, but for some we also will be face a situation when C++ is only a way for you to solve the problem. Okay, and the first thing that I want to tell you about is std vector. So std vector, like you all of you are using it, I'm pretty sure, but probably not all of you know how it actually works. So what is the vector? Basically is some kind of array of dynamic size, so we can push back, we can resize, we can put back, and a lot of different methods also we have in the vector. So for this kind of operations, vector uses dynamic allocation. That is, memory is allocated on the heap. So when you write like size of std vector, you will always get some small numbers like 16 or 32 or 24. So that means that in its structure, vector has just a pointer to some memory which is allocated on the heap. That means that these allocations are not always efficient. That means that we have some overhead because of uses such kind of memory, and that means that there are cases when you probably will try to use std vector, but it will lead to absolutely bad efficiency, like it will be huge increase of execution time. So how it actually works? It has inner buffer, like pointer allocates some buffer with some capacity. And if after some pushback operations size reaches capacity, like size equal capacity, then buff on next such operation pushback, vector will reallocate buffer with the size equal capacity multiplied by 2. This is how it works in GCC. It's not how it's defined in C++ standard, but this is how it works for GCC and CLang or Clang, how you call it, like compilers. Visual Studio compiler does the same, but with factor 1.5. It was such factor like a couple of years ago. So the idea is pretty simple, but it allows us with like O1 access O n total time. It allows us to use dynamic size for some kind of array structure. What you should know, that vector does not deallocate its memory after pullback or clear operation, so its own it's like capacity remains the same after pullback and clear. So if you really want to free the memory, there are some methods of vector which are called shrink to fit, or you can just destroy vector object by assigning it another one like empty, or using swap with some other vector which will be destroyed later. So to deallocate memory, to free memory, you need to do something else. Also the same about resize operations, assign, like all of them do not freeze the memory if you reduce vector size. Also you can reserve this capacity using method reserve, and it kind of allows you to achieve almost the same performance as std array. I mean, if you use a lot of pushbacks, then it will not reallocate the memory and you will not have any kind of overhead because of reallocations. Okay, next 3 points. So if you have some huge vector of like 100k elements, 100k, when I say 100k, it's 100,000 elements, it's usually as fast as just using some global static array. It's like there is no difference in accessing its data by pointer or by index or like any other simple way. What should you be worry about? Like it's a use case when you create a vector for some small kind of small data, like say size 2, 5, 16 elements, and so on. You will have huge overhead because of memory allocation, because of additional overhead of pointer how to say разыменование указателя, because like you will have a huge
dereference of pointer.
Yeah, thank you. Because of the reference of pointer, so you will have huge overhead, and like the worst idea which you can have is to use std vector of std vectors for something like matrices 2x2 for some, you know, dynamic programming or multiplications or like any other case, because it will be super slow, like 10 times slower probably. And like some new guys in competitive programming can face this issue quite often. Like when you have known size, use std array or structure or std pair or like anything else which have no dynamic allocations. Yeah, later I will, when we will discuss the memory, I will tell you why actually like dynamic memory allocations are slow, why we have an overhead when you're using them. Std map and the std set, they're based on self-balancing binary search trees. Basically, it's B-tree, as I know in most of implementations. So, you know, when you have tree, you for sure should use dynamic allocation. It's like, and you should have some pointers like left child, right child, and it gives you huge memory overhead, and it gives you huge constant factor because, again, you have a lot of the reference operations and so on when you try to make some queries to estimate or std set. There are a couple of tricks which not everyone knows about std map, std set. For example, methods erase return number of erased elements, and method insert returns pair with Boolean value, which means if insertion was successful, if there was no such element before. And that actually allows us to optimize some constructions, like when we check if there is already some value in set and there is no, we insert and do something else like DFS or some like dynamic calculations in some, I don't know, yeah, so like if you have such construction, it usually can be optimized to only one query, one call of set or web method for both like erase and insert. Also, there is an insert specialization which accepts iterator and value. And iterate into position where you think that value should be inserted. So if you insert several sorted values, several sorted elements in set, it can be optimized by, I guess, up to two times or even more. If you pass iterator like to position where previous element was inserted, it's kind of also some kind of optimization which can be used for such structures. Unordered map, unordered set, it's kind of hash table in C++. You know, hash table is very complex data structure, I would say, because it has a lot of different implementations and it's not so good as it looks in terms of time complexity. Again, like it's better than std map or std set, which have O log for most of the operations, like insert erase. But usually, an ordered map and an ordered set will be slower. Also, you can face a note author of the task which added anti an order set test or like some hack on the forces which will make your time complexity all unsquared. Yeah, but also an order map and reset can be kind of optimized using some configurable parameters with methods max load factor, rehash, and reserve. Like you can read later what these methods do. And if you will try to get good results with an ordered map or an ordered set, you should take a look on these methods as well. Okay. Next thing is study string. So interesting thing about the study string is that in the old versions of GCC, it had very tricky implementations, like it was storing some small strings on the stack memory, you know, using union structure or like feature of C and C++. And it was also using copy and write technique. That was basically means that if you like write string S equals string T, then it will not actually create a copy of string T like it does now. It was just making a reference to it. So it was like, if you know std shared pointer or std like weak pointer, so the same idea. String acquired ownership on data only when you try to modify the data. But starting from C++11, standard requires it to use like the same kind of optimization as some kind of implementation as it is for the vector. So even interface like pushback, shrink to fit, resize, some specific methods, they are very similar to std vector. What can you face as a problem with strings is when you do some kind of pushback using operator plus, but not plus equal, and you will have like on or size s for each kind of such operation. Vector bool. Interesting to know about this template specialization is that it's absolutely different from std vector for other types, just because it uses memory compression, like in a bit set. Yes?
There are some questions in the chat, so you can...
Okay, yeah. Okay, you see. Is it true that small string are created on the stack? Yeah, so as I said, it was like this, but in previous versions, in very old versions of GCC, before C++11 was introduced, like storing small strings in the stack of memory. So it was true. Right now, it isn't true. We can check, like, it's not defined by standard, I guess. We can check GCC, but I remember as that they removed this logic after they removed copy on write technique. Yeah. I think if it's true, it actually does not change a lot of for us as a competitive programmer. Yeah, std vector bool. Yeah, so as I said, it's very specific, so it uses memory compression as in std bit set, so we have 8 elements in each byte. So we have no, we can't get a pointer to the like is element of the such vector, and like this is kind of optimization, but it's very, I would say, it's not good idea to make this when you have a very general structure, like a std vector, which is used for all the different types, but for bool you have something specific. When we compare it to a std bit set, we have here dynamic size, so we can push back the size and so on, but we lose all the binary arithmetic operations like OR and shifting. So it's kind of advantage and disadvantage comparing to std bit set. Yep, std bit set, it's very good data structure as for me, because it doesn't use dynamic memory allocations. So std bit set, you know, it requires template parameter size, so it should be at compile time, and that's because of the fact that it doesn't use the network allocation, so it should be allocated on the stack. We have all kind of binary arithmetic operations for std bit set, so we can use it in our code base, like in our solutions, in different ways. As I said, like it's very efficient, and it's hard to imagine a situation when a std bit set will not work for you, but some custom implementation will be better. But if you lack some kind of operations, you can do the trick which is described in the first point of this slide. So you can cast pointer to the bit set to pointer to the int or some other type like char, long, which you want. And you can implement some specific logic which you need, like for your own bit set. So for example, if you want to apply like AND or XOR operations to the elements of the bit set as to integer, or like computing bits, like more often use case is computing number of set bits on some range from L to R, you can use built-in function and loop, which will go over this integer values, which you get after casting pointer to int star. Like it's not guaranteed by standards that we can do that. It's not guaranteed that the order is always the same as we usually implement bit set it, but it usually works. And why we use the bit set in competitive programming? So it really combines the logic of three different structures. Like we can use it as dynamic programming data, for example, for some kind of knapsack problems, or for other problems when we can express our dynamic programming array as a Boolean array, and we can recalculate new values using binary operations. So it's, you know, time complexity divided by 32, it's about this use case. Also, it can be used just as efficient Boolean array. Advantage is it that the size will be 8 times smaller. I will tell you later about like why it's a huge advantage actually sometimes. And also we can use it as set functionality when we have O1 for really fast O1 for insert erase or find function. and a bit worse time, a bit huge memory overhead and some limitation on other operations, like iterating over it and so on. But it's really fast insert, erase, or find with a steady bit set. Okay, do we have some more questions? So memory uses vector boolean. Yes, memory usage should be the same, except the fact that vector bool use some reservation. So in worst case, vector bool can have two times more than we need actually memory. Small string optimization works on Apple's client, even in C++. Okay, thank you for this information. Wasn't sure about it. Thank you for fix. Okay, yeah, I agree with you. Probably it will work as well. Okay, any other question about stdbitset? Okay. And the last thing from STL which I want to point on is std array. Std array is basically a wrapper of the style arrays, T size. But interface is typical for STL containers. We have begin, we have end, we can iterate this for range loop, most of the methods which are common for STL containers, they are present in std array. It also doesn't use dynamic memory allocations. It has comparison operations, so we can use it as element of the set and key of the map. And actually for that use case, like key of the map, it will be much more efficient than a vector, just because comparison of the arrays when we know size will be much better optimized by compiler. And also, we will not have dynamic the reference and the dynamic memory allocations for our key there. So if you have some complex task where you go over different states and you encode the states, then it will be much more efficient to encode the states into some std array this exercise than using dynamic size vector. Of course, if idea of solution allows to do that. Yeah, and the last use case which I want to highlight about std array is that we can use it for small number of rounds, for three or four numbers, a lot of people continue to use all these terrible pair structures which are not readable and easy to make a mistake in the code, and in C++ 11, std array allows us to write much better code in such cases. There is also std tuple, but it's kind of not so useful when we want to access its elements because std get. So I think array wins in such use case over all the other data structures. Of course. In our compiler sense, yes. In our compiler, you mean Uzhgorod server? If yes, that's cool. Okay. Yeah, but sadly, C++ 17 is not available everywhere. Yeah, like Tuple is also a good solution. It has no any kind of overhead compared to STD array, and the STD array has no overhead compared to Tuple or user-defined structure. Okay, that was everything about STL. What I wanted to highlight in this lecture. Connection was new. Okay, let me 10 seconds to take a rest. Okay, let me check the time, and I need to write a short message, like 30 seconds, and we will continue. Okay, I was written some message about contest preparation, so yeah. Says before, okay. Okay, so let's continue. Go. Okay. One second, sorry. Okay. The contest is ready, is one right contest. Yep. Just need to update some tests and tasks descriptions for that contest, because your judge and polygon has a bit different behavior. Okay, fast input output. So quickly we'll go through this block of my presentation. So you know, like in competitive programming, we input and output huge amount of data, and sometimes we are slow in it, we can be slow. So what I want to highlight in this topic, it's What usually is used for optimization of such things like input output is buffering. It's basically when you write something, for example, into file, it isn't written to the file directly. It usually written to some buffer, and sometimes when buffer is full, it flushes the data to the file. The same it works when we the same behavior we have with standard input output like console output and so on. So we use stdhandle for like our manual flashing, or there is some automatic flashing inside C++ implementation of input output. So if we use cin and cout in the same like loop or same block of code, then it will force using a flush after each operations, because they are kind of synchronized in that, and you can disable that by command cin tie zero. It will break behavior in interactive tasks, so don't use it there. Also, there is a synchronization between C style input and C++ style input and output. So printf is gonna have, usually you can use both of them in the code, but when you call command IOS base sync with stdio zero, it will just disable this synchronization. It will give you significant speed up for most of the operations, but it will also make it impossible to use printf scanf correctly in the same code. Like, I guess you can still use them calling flashes directly, but I'm not sure, like, it's better to not risk with this. Sometimes we even want to implement some custom input and output by ourselves, and it will be really much faster comparing to the cin, cout, printf, scanf, just because, for example, scanf, printf, it has formatting string. It should handle a lot of different formatting options. It should handle a lot of errors. When you do that, you don't care about that. You make it much faster and simple. The same about streams, like C in, C out, they also handle a lot of different operations, which we just skip and don't care about in competitive programming. So simplest implementation uses getchar. Like, not simplest, there is one when we can just input the lines using getline or stdgets, and after that we can parse the lines like integer numbers of any other information from these lines. Or we can use getchar, like taking one character by one from the input stream and implementing logic like of reading integer by yourself. For fastest, absolutely fastest implementation, we also should implement buffering by ourselves. And I want to show the implementation which I use. So let me go briefly about through it. So I have a buffer, and like first part of the code just implements getchar function, it's lambda here, using buffering of size 4 kilobytes. You see, like, logic is pretty straightforward, nothing hard here. And in second part of this function, we just take one character until we do not get like digit or sign minus, we will skip all other characters, handle possible minus character, and then just go through all the digit characters which we get from the input. Yeah, and it will be like extremely fast, and I don't think that you can implement something simple and as fast as like as this. So in the same way we can implement, for example, write functions. We just need to go in the opposite direction. We write our information into the buffer, and when buffer is full, we just output it to cout or there is C style write yesterday out, if I'm not wrong. So it has absolutely the same performance as C++ input output of the, like bunch of data. So yep, that is about input output. Let me check the questions. Is it faster than ScanF? Yes, it's for sure faster. It's much faster. In latest versions of compilers, I think sometimes C++ 11 streams can be as fast as ScanF printf, like if you use all this synchronization disabled, but custom implementation will be always faster than something provided to you from C or C++. Okay, we can go to the next block. Efficient memory. So this is about a bit more deep level of optimization, efficient implementation. So work with memory is very important, and it's actually very unclear for us as programmers, because we probably don't worry about it when we solve the tasks, so it's a competitive programming task. So why memory allocations, why dynamic memory is slow? First point which I want you to say, like, let's try to imagine the memory management as a competitive programming task. So we have a huge buffer of memory. It's like a big array of bytes. And we want to perform several types of queries. Like, the simplest case is allocation. The allocation is kind of query. Allocation is find and resolve some empty segment of size n. And the allocation is query find index of segment. We give you a pointer, which is like an index of the first element of the segment. And we should say like how many memory we allocated there and free that memory. So we can use that memory later for the first type of queries. Like, I'm pretty sure that you will be able to solve that tasks, but it will be obviously not so like straightforward and easy to think that memory allocation is super fast or one operation which we can use free without any overhead. Obviously, you will have some process like time overhead on such operations, and obviously you will need some memory overhead to store information about how much memory did you allocate or like in that particular place. So yep, that's kind of already gives us information, so that dynamic memory allocations are not so fast as like other O1 operations. Also memory is managed not only by your program but by operation system. So it should give the memory to different programs, to different process. It should do that concurrently. That means in different threads. So the all memory allocation, like memory allocations by operation system, should be thread safe. And also there are a lot of different stuff which is kind of a safety, like privacy of the memory. So one program shouldn't be able to read the memory of the other program. Like if all the memory was one array, then it will not work, you know. So there are a lot of complex stuff about memory allocations, and that's why actually it's very slow usually when you just use STD or like new or delete operator or some C operators, malloc, for example. Yep. Let me check, no questions. Okay, continue. We usually assume that random memory access is just like O1. So simple, fast operations just read the integer from array or write integer to array, but that actually isn't true. I mean, it's not completely true. So we have a lot of different like optimizations in our processors, like mostly they're called caches. They use different cache lines, but it's kind of details. But we have, for example, four level of caches, L1, L2, L3, L4. And depending on which level of cache our data is located right now, depending on that, the speed of memory access, the performance will be very different. I write in my slides that you can assume that for big sizes of memory, like it works like O square root of N. And what does it mean? That if you have like 100 megabytes array, then it will be 10 times slower for random access than some 1 megabyte array. And again, like 1 megabyte array will be 10 times slower than wow, 10 kilobytes array. And that's actually true. You can check it implementing some correct tests where you will not have overhead on some other operations, but only on memory access, like read and write. And that means that using correct strategy with memory, we can achieve like very different performance in the same with the same algorithm or like with the same time complexity. Do we have a message? Complaints it will definitely be the big talk, but okay, thank you, Denise. Yeah. So when you ask like process or like computer read some memory, it can move that memory on the several level of caches, like copying the huge memory several times from one cache line to another cache line, from one cache level to another cache level. And it's also like probably it's even unclear for me how all the stuff implemented, but what we should know that the more memory we use, the slower access to this memory is. Yeah, and because of these points, vector bools and std bit set may be faster than simple array of boolean values like or std array or c style array. And like, for example, you can really see it implementing big prime sieve, like I think about 10 and power 8, I guess. Like it will work pretty fast in 1 second or two, but it will be faster with smaller array size, which will be with vector bool or std bit set. And even like for accessing std bit set elements, you need to compute a couple more arithmetic operations, the binary arithmetic operations. But even through like even with that, you will be faster just because memory access will be much faster. Also, because of all this stuff, because of all this reasoning, it's sometimes better to replace long in your some big array with int, or int with short, or even char if you can. So the smaller data you have, the more efficiency you can achieve with your program. Another point is about sequential memory access. So when you use sequential memory access, the memory like which you access, it's already located on the most deeper level of cache, like. And it's super efficient, and you may assume that reading some memory which is continuous, it will can be even faster than O1. I mean that sometimes process can parallel some operations, so like it will go to, I will talk about it a bit later. It's vectorization and so on. So sequential memory access, it is what we want for most fastest for what we want for fastest solutions, for fastest implementation. And that's why dynamic memory allocations are also bad, because dynamic memory doesn't mean that it will be located in the same region of the memory, so you can allocate like 64 elements in one place, and after that next query to the new memory will get 64 elements from absolutely another place of your memory, and it will work like a random access. That's why for example segment 3, which is implemented on a static array, is much faster than segment 3, which is implemented in pointers. Yep, so there are ways how to avoid dynamic memory allocations, not only using like some global array like we do in segment 3, because like in segment 3, the key feature of plain segment 3 is that we use indexing arithmetic to build this tree. So we always know that vertex with index x has sums on the positions 2x and 2x plus 1. But for some other cases, like Cartesian tree, implicit segment tree, any binary trees with rotations and other stuff, suffix automation and other string data structures, you can't use such tricks there. So you need to use some allocations or some queries, like please give me new vertex, new node for my data structure. In such cases, we can use such thing as object pools approach or bump memory allocations. Bump memory allocations is basically when you override operator new and you just have some static big buffer with the memory and you just return the memory from this static buffer. So you will ignore deallocations in such case, and it's absolutely fine for most of the cases in competitive programming, like nobody cares about memory leaks there. Okay, so yeah, and object pool approach, it's when you have, again, you have a big predefined array of some objects, like nodes for your segment tree or any other tree. And instead of constructing its using operator new, you just take some free object from this pool. So for this approach, sometimes you can use like a stack of indices with free objects. So with this approach, you can support the allocations, or you can just use the same approach as in bump allocator. So you can just keep index of last used element from your global pool and just make plus plus after you allocate in such way new object. And again, it will be much more efficient for your structures than using dynamic memory allocations on heap. Okay, because it doesn't invalidate pointer storage for any applications. Okay, STD deck, I didn't prepare information about it when I was preparing to this lecture, so probably yes, it makes sense when you can't evaluate efficiently enough how many elements you need for your solution. It will have some overhead, I'm pretty sure, but probably it will work in some cases as well. STD deck. Static array accessing the same as accessing big buffer created on the heap on the first line of main. Same as accessing some big buffer created on the heap on the first line of main. In most cases, yes. The only thing about all the static created objects that address of this object, which is like pointer to this object, is known at compile time. If I'm not lying to you. Yeah, I guess it's so. So we have kind of static memory, how it's called? Don't remember exactly, but yeah, like usually static elements, static objects have known where they are located in compile time, but after we take some pointer to the static array, or like we pass the pointer to its elements in some function, or like in most other cases, it gives absolutely no advantage. So you may assume that some big buffer created on the heap will be as fast and as efficient as static array. Yeah. So that was actually what I said in when I told you about vector, std vector. So when std vector is big and you just access it elements without any kind of pushbacks and resizes, then it will be as efficient as a simple global array. Okay. So that was all the questions from this block. And how many times do we have? I guess about 12 minutes. Started a bit later, yeah. So last block of my lecture will be actually about how to achieve like best performance using low level optimizations. And there are not a lot of information about that in my slides. So the first point is actually that there are a lot of information, a lot of different techniques which can apply to optimize the computations on the deepest level. I mean, it's the level of assembly operations. Yeah. So, but like, let's start from something bigger. Yeah, and first what I want to highlight, so remember that you have, if you have tail, it doesn't mean for sure that it's because your implementation is slow. Sometimes you may have just some bug in your code, and actually when we were involved finals last time with our common team, Ujno Perforce, I was solving some problem with kind of not so good time complexity, which was about O n power 4 in power 4 when n was about 200 or 500. So it was not so good, but it was for sure possible to solve the task with that complexity. And I got tail verdict and I thought, okay, let's start to optimize it. And I spent a lot of time trying to improve my efficiency of my code. But actually, I have stupid bug when my 2D array was just small in one dimension. And just on the stage of the input of the data, I had kind of tail just because it was some, let's say, undefined behavior. But what you should always remember, the first thing which you should think about, do I have some bugs in my code? If you don't, then you should understand in which part of code you have bottleneck, which part of the code you need to optimize. Usually, as like when you wrote your solution, you know where you have which time complexity, and you don't need actually to measure execution time. But sometimes it's better to measure, to create some sample huge test and look which parts of your code make it work slower. Also, creating some kind of testing can help you understand if your changes make your solution better. That will help you to avoid situations when you have like 20 or 30 submissions on the task, trying to optimize the code and just like letting compiler judge system to check if you improved your code or if you don't know, if you or if you didn't do that. Yeah, and always think about like, are you able to find a correct solution which author used in this task before trying to like optimize solution with runtime complexity, and it will be, in most of the cases, it will be much more profitable to try to understand if your solution can be improved in terms of time complexity instead of optimizing it. But if you are familiar with low-level optimization, if you are sure that you probably can achieve some results even with wrong asymptotic, like you can do that, and I actually did it a lot of times. Okay, so what we should know about operations, like low single operations, not all one operations of the same efficiency level. We already know that from discussing of the memory, and it works as well for some kind of arithmetic operations, like plus, minus, assignment are most efficient. Multiplication is a bit more expensive, like several times, and division and modulo operations as they are extremely expensive. So try to avoid these operations in your solutions. And also remember that dividing by constant value can be optimized by some algorithm, and this algorithm is usually used by compilers. So for sure, when you have division by two, you don't need to replace it by shifting to the right in one bit, because like a lot of years ago, it was implemented in compilers, and they can do that instead of you. But also, compiler can optimize it some other divisions, like division by 23, let's say. There is an algorithm which allows to play such division with some multiplication and, if I'm not wrong, binary operations. You can Google about it later. So it's usually very good to have most of the data which you can in as a constant expressions or just a constants or known at compile time. Yeah, floating point operations are more expensive than integer, but if we say just about float type, but double, then it's pretty much as fast as int on the recent architectures, on the recent machines. But still, like the most efficient is usage of integer operations. Most of optimizations Compiler can do for you. So there are two pragmas which can enable higher level optimizations. So it's so fast. It enables some optimizations which sometimes can make your program even slower. One of example of such optimization is loop unrolling. So what loop unrolling does? When you have some long loop, you can do like several operations on the same iteration of this loop. For example, I will enable presentation of the screen a bit later and tell you a bit more about this. So loop unrolling is one of the things which compiler can does can do for you. Also, it's good to make your code as simple as you can, so it will be much easier to analyze in the compiler to understand which code is safe to be optimized. And as I said before, you should use constant and constant expression as much as possible, so compiler will be sure that these values are not optimized or are not changed in some other code, or these values are not like these values are just constants, so it will be not requiring additional registers or like storage, any kind of storage, so it will be used just directly in assembly instructions. STDMEM set and memcopy are also good functions when works, which works very fast, and if you need like this kind of logic, like to clear some array, to copy some array, like just use this function, it will be super efficient. There is such thing which is called vectorization, when processor can evaluate several operations using one instruction. So compiler can does it for you, and actually in this pragma, in second pragma, it enables SSE instructions and AVX instructions, just a bit different set of instructions. So these are instructions for vectorized calculations. And these instructions can do several like evaluation in one single assembly instruction. So let me show you some example. I will enable screen sharing for different tab. There is such service called gccgotbolt.org. It can show you like your disassembly in real time, and it's super cool for like online competitions if you want to optimize some code or just like some task which you want to like look at code and see how compiler works with your stuff. So let me choose GCC, which is used on Užhorod server, and let me show you some example. So you see we have like, let's use O2 here, and let's write some simple function which will take like pointer to some array, and you will apply some operation. Let's say it will be like this. So you see right now it's have pretty simple assembly instruction. So all this loop is implemented, is compiled into four assembly instructions. So it's simply changing the pointer address. This, I guess, this is adding basically the value. This is condition of the loop end. And this is jump to the beginning, like go to, or we finish this function. But if we will enable our vectorized optimization with pragmas, let's see what will happen with our function. You see, we have much more assembly now. So this is why sometimes these pragmas can make your code work slower, just because some small things which are not, shouldn't be vectorized, they became much more complex, And, you know, cache your code, like assembly instructions, should also be cached, so should also be compact, and when it's large, it will be slow. But if this code is a bottleneck, then compiler will do good optimization for us, and let me explain you how exactly it does it. So streamed operations are done by these assembly instructions. So you see, instead of simple add or compare add or move operations, it uses V add, V move. V means vectorized, and it processes four elements using one assembly instruction. So basically, this code will do the next thing. It will work like this. We can handle like the processed elements a bit like after this loop, but let's not look on it. So when I help compiler, when I say to compile that I want vectorization here, you see we have much less assembly, and basically, it will be almost the same, but will not handle other cases. For other cases, what can we do? It's like for so that will basically the same what compiler did for us with just a simple loop, and this loop will be four times about, not four, but I think three times faster than original one. But like the main speed up is because we use vectorized instructions, which process several times, several elements in one instruction. What is the link? In what situations pragmas can you cause runtime exception? In the situations when we enable some instructions, for example, AVX2, which are probably not supported by the system on which it's compiled or which it's run. For example, some Yandex contests, they have different machines for compilation, I guess, and for execution, and they can like compile on one machine which has such instructions and execute on the another machine which has no such instruction, and you will get bad instruction exception. Basically, it doesn't require, as I know, different machines. It can happen as well on the single machine. So usually you can be safe with SSE2, SSE, and AVX. So AVX2 is not supported everywhere, and SSE4 probably not, but I guess such pragmas are pretty safe to that you will not be getting runtime exceptions. Okay. Another example, what I want to show you. Imagine that we implement copying of two arrays. It will end in 5 minutes. Yeah. So let me show. By the way, isn't it small? Like, do you have enough quality of the image to see it? Like, I can make it this bigger a bit. Okay, so when we do this stuff, there are actually a lot of code, and there is one use case when compiler has problems with vectorization of this. For example, imagine that you have the next code. And it will be safe in all the situations, but if we replace it with the next one, like let's create temporary variables. So this code might look the same, but it produces much less assembly. You know why? Because this code will work in a different way if your pointers A and B are very close, like B equal R plus one, for example, or R minus one. In such case, the behavior will be different because previous code in such case was working like assigning same element to the whole array just because like when we do something like b0 equal r0, it's the same as r1 equal r0, and then it'll go by chain to the end of the like b equal r plus one. Yeah, but if you assume that your pointers are not intersecting, then your compiler, okay, let me fix the issue. Then your compiler, will do it in much more optimal way. So there are a lot of details about all the stuff with vectorization, but if you will keep things like make the code as simple as you can and avoid some operations which are not able to be vectorized, then compiler will help you and do most of the work by itself. And last small point which I want to mention is branching. Branching is kind of ifs. So let's take a look on the next code name, on the next function. If element less than x, element equal y. You see, it's not vectorized. It's so simple, but not vectorized. But there is an easy trick how to make this code vectorizable. And the trick looks the next way. Let's make an else in which we do the next. Okay, it didn't work. Not now it does. You see, we assign the same value to itself and compiler does vectorization for us. Why it happens? Just because when we didn't do that, compiler sees that in some cases he can't access this write operation array elements, and in that cases it's not too safe for him using vectorization, because vectorization applies assigning to all the four elements, like it can't skip elements. But if you say that it's okay to assign the same value as it was before, compiler understands that this code can be easily vectorized because all the operations are vectorizable. You can ask like how the comparison is vectorizable. I will say you that there is an instruction which does in the single instruction some logic like compare and assign if comparison is successful. This instruction is for both like vectorizing operations and not vectorizing, and this instructions allow compiler to avoid branching in a huge amount of situations, and it's really cool that our processors have such instructions, because in other cases you will have construction like this, like two instructions. One is compare, another instruction will be jump, and after jump you will also have some more instructions. And when processor doesn't know like will it jump on this instruction or will it will continue is it another instruction, it will be very slow. There are such things like code predictions and other things which help compiler to execute several instructions on one processor tact. I'm not sure if I say tact correctly in English, like one moment of processor execution, it can actually compute several instructions, not only one. And avoiding some branching, like jumps in assembly code, can help improve the performance of your code significantly. Yep, that's all, I think. The last small point about like why all this stuff is in, like why I'm looking at the stuff. So there is such thing as matrix multiplication, which is used very in a lot of different areas of computer science. For example, in machine learning, matrix multiplication is a core operations, and like all neural networks, it's just like 90% of execution time is matrix multiplication. And probably each of you knows how to implement matrix multiplication, but I would say you that simple O(n) in the power of 3 algorithm can be optimized by tens or hundreds of times just using some techniques of factorization and good memory accessing. So like constant time optimizations can improve not only like 2 times or 3 times, sometimes they can improve with your code like 100 times. Let me check the questions. Does the pragmas work with Linux? Yes, this pragmas works for both Linux, Windows, macOS, and GCC, Clang. Probably they don't work with Visual Studio, but I'm just not sure because I'm not using Visual Studio. Like Visual Studio compiler, you can use GCC in Visual Studio for sure. I think floating numbers doubles do not like this pragmas as I go to runtime search more than one time because is it right if the problem was another thing. So that is was the problem which I told you that sometimes compiler may use instructions which are not supported by your processor if you include a lot of excessive like information is this pragma. So there are some discussion in code forces about that, but like SSE supported by all the architectures which we have in like last 20 years, I guess, and they have like a lot of operations. But with AVX, we can achieve a little bit better results. In some cases, you see much smaller number of operations we have with AVX and with SSE. So SSE super safe. Different versions of SSE can cause some issues, and AVX is pretty safe, I think, as well. AVX one. Next questions. Thread. Tick, tick. Yeah, one processor tick. Thank you. So what is code of matrix multiplication with optimization? There is an article on Habra. Let me find the link. Effective implementation step by step. It's in Russian, but you can look on the code samples and kind of translation of results which are achieved by these optimizations. So let me post the link. You can read this article later. So we just, like in that multiplication, we just change the order in which we process the data, and we just do some copying of the data into small buffers to keep the data in the cache. But key idea is that for simple matrix multiplication, we always need O n in power of 3 multiplications. Like not O n power of 3, but exactly n power of 3 multiplications. And in like 100 times optimized solution, we also have the same number of multiplications. But the way in which we do these multiplications, which we do these assembly operations, and in the way in which memory is loaded, like memory loaded to register to perform some operations, it changes a lot, and it gives significant boost to our implementation. Is ternary operator always faster than ifs? It does redundant assignment. So you see, in such case, it helps compiler to vectorize the code. So it will not do redundant assignment if, I think, if it will not vectorize this code. Like compiler understand if you assign the same value to the same. Like, is short faster than int? Usually short is slower than int because most of like computations are like simple assembly instructions. They are implemented for int, and basically when you do short plus short, your result will be int. For simple like instruction, it's how C++ defines these operations. So result like char plus char will be int. Result of short plus short will be int. But for example, if you have vectorized code, short is 2 bytes. Vectorized register are 16 bytes. So with int, vectorized instructions can make 4 operations in set time with a single instruction. But with short, vectorized instructions can do 8 operations and they will be faster. So it really depends on the use case, but like usually short is slower, like for simple instructions. But for vectorized instructions, it will be for sure faster. And also like, if you have some big memory and it's stored in short, then array size will be smaller and memory read will be also faster. So you always should think about like what exactly the bottleneck here and what compiler will do with your data in exact place. Why unsend long form faster than long form? I'm not sure, because like simple arithmetic operations, they are absolutely the same on like plus and minus for unsend long and send long, but probably there is some difference again in vectorized instructions when you do something like what can you do? Comparisons. When counter starts, I'm not sure. I think we should ask Anton Cepko if he is here, or Alexander Vladimirovich. Okay. Sorry guys, I'm not sure. I need to ask organizers of the school. Yeah, if it's in 11, then like we finish and you can prepare. Vectorized instructions used only if we use pragmas. I think no. I remember there are some cases when compiler can vectorize the code even if you do not enable or fast. I don't know. Like, it depends on compiler, because like all the stuff is very complicated for compilers, just because you know, it's really hard to implement such analyzers which will be like able to understand where they can apply vectorization, where it will be more faster, when it will be not safe. So it's really complicated in terms of compilers. So compilers don't have some kind of straight rules where you can read, like, in such case GCC will vectorize my code, in such case GCC will not. It usually really depends on some heuristics in compilers. So best way to understand it, measure execution time or look on assembly. Yeah, VX instructions. It's just a different instruction set. Like some of them were in Intel processor, some in all the processors. Like AVX is only in Intel. Usually, pragma unroll loops is used as well. Is it reasonable? Good question. So pragma unroll loops sometimes is reasonable, sometimes is not, because of the one thing. So how to explain? Imagine assembly of some simple loop. Let's say it's like this. I will disable it. Presentation. So let's say like assembly for loop like this. It will fit into cache of the code, like code cache, and it will be executed fast. You do additional unroll, like instead of executing 4 or 8 operations, you will try to execute, let's say, 64 operations. And it will be like this. And in such case, it will become much slower, just because this loop will be not in the cache of the processor, which like there is such a the code is the data. Assembly instructions, it's also the data which is located somewhere in the processor memory. So if compiler unrolled loop too much, then it will become slower. So I usually do not use this pragma, because it sometimes can improve, sometimes cannot, but you can always check like what works faster with Pragma or without. Yeah, unrolling loops is included in OFAST for sure, but sometimes like it can be unrolled more, sometimes it can be unrolled less. Okay, I guess we have 15 minutes until start of contest. Like, if you won't leave this meeting, you can. If you want to stay and ask something else, I guess it is the same. Let me check. If you didn't have any messages about
try a few more questions in the chat.
We have a moment. I will check the status. The quota start time. Oh, when I will start it. Okay, let's start it at 11:15. I will not start it earlier for sure. So if you have 15 minutes to take a rest and to prepare to the contest. Anyone English speaking still here? Or Link, sorry, Link. I guess it's linked to. Okay, probably like you have the link to the previous contest that just replaced the contest ID with 316. I'm not sure what the link for contestants, but not for administrator. Like for administrator, it's new master in the end, but for contestant, it should be something else, I don't remember. So contest ID 316, just replace it in the old link. About the contest, if something wonder, there is tasks which are kind of for directly for the topic of the contest on the lecture, like to optimize something. But please always do what I suggested on lecture, like think about idea, think about like will optimize solution work fast enough. And try to not get like hundreds of wrong submissions. Trying to optimize something. Pay attention to memory limits.
Is there one more question in the chat?
What's the Pragma for floating point operations? It's the same. Like there are with REST instructions for floating point. Like you can try on Godbolt to replace int with float, and you will see that it does utilization as well. Floating point operations. Yeah. Okay. Okay, the fence skip, does this make the code faster? No, it's just some disabling of warnings. You know, warnings when compiler or IDE highlights something with like saying, like, you do something wrong here. I don't remember exactly, probably it's for some input functions like gets or get char. You can just Google it, but like it's not making code faster for sure.
Жені, нам потрошки треба контест починати.
Ми начно 11:15 перенесли старт. Там треба умови оновити, бо в них там нема останніх змін. Я написав.